Well, we're going to get started, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us. We have a lot of different activities ongoing this evening, but we understand there are a group of students who are heading this way from the Bird Center. They thought the other Bird Center was the, yes, so that's okay. We are grateful to Senator Byrd for all the Bird Centers, okay? So, good evening and welcome everyone to the President's Lecture Series. This is part of Shepherd University's Lifelong Learning Program under the remarkable directorship of Karen Rice. Karen, thank you so much for everything that you do. This evening, we are delighted to have the opportunity to hear from Dr. Richard Trost, a toxicologist and recognized expert in the toxicity of lead to humans. He is founder of Trost Environmental Consulting, and tonight's lecture will address the environmental sources of lead and the potential effects of the continuing exposure of lead for children and adults. Dr. Trost started his career at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, known as the EPA, working in the Pesticide Safety Office, and then advanced throughout the EPA during his 33-year career. After retiring in 2004, Dr. Trost worked on a three-year assignment with the U.S. Agency for International Development in the Kingdom of Jordan, developing a hazardous waste control strategy for Jordan's Ministry of the Environment, a very exciting job indeed. Dr. Trost is a graduate of West Virginia University with a BA and MS degrees in biology and biochemistry, respectively, and he received his PhD from George Mason University in environmental science and toxicology. He founded Trost Environmental Consulting in 2009 to represent people who have been exposed to hazardous chemicals, especially lead, which is still found in some homes in paint, interior water pipes, and as dust from industrial sources. Dr. Trost enjoys supporting school science fairs and environmental issues through the US EPA Alumni Council. And that's when he isn't visiting with his grandchildren and with his wife, Judy, who joined us this evening. She received her BA degree from Alderson Broaddus College and her MS degree in biology from WVU. So we have a lot of West Virginia history here and our two wonderful guests. Dr. Trost will discuss the relationship of exposure from lead in the environment and the known health effects identified in adults and children, with special emphasis on the neurological issues identified in young children with blood lead levels above the acceptable threshold recommended by the CDC. And then following tonight's lecture, we will have a reception in the lobby, which is sponsored by the Shepherd University Foundation. So thank you very much. This is going to be a very exciting lecture, and we encourage you to ask all the questions you'd like afterwards. Thank you. Dr. Trost.
Thank you, Dr. Hendricks. Okay, can everybody see that? Okay, fine. Should we wait a little bit longer or just start? Okay. What this slide represents is all of these components. Air, that's perfect. Air, waters, emitted lead, indoor dust, paint, outdoor soil, all come together right here. And to some extent here and here, but we're going to focus here as human exposure, occupational, you know? Like you see on TV now. So, first thing we have to do as a toxicologist is understand the difference between exposure and risk. Exposure is when you take something in or it's nearby to you. But risk, as every good toxicologist knows, is the definition is written by Kazret and Dool, very, very old toxicology textbook. And this was in the preface, written by John Dool, recently died. I had the pleasure of meeting him several times in my career. And what is there that is not a poison? Think about that for a minute. What isn't a poison? Is there anything? We'll get the answer to that. All things are poison, and nothing is without poison. And finally, the dose determines that a thing is not a poison. Or said the other way, dose determines what is a poison. Simply said, dose and dose rate make a poison. Here we have a nice bag of water being gently poured on somebody's head. Hardly a poison, correct? Here's that 50-pound bag of water. That is poisonous, or at least toxic. The dose and the rate confer toxicity. So, past and present sources, as you noted earlier, contaminated soils, lead-based paint, older homes, we'll talk about, define what they are, industrial releases, toys, lead-based paint, and pipelines and fixtures. All of these are ever present around us as humans. So, let's start with lead and water. Had the most publicity in the last year and a half or so. And so that everybody knows what we're starting at, the legal primary drinking water standard, 15 parts per billion. That is the legally enforceable standard, and it applies to public water systems. Anybody here on a private well? You're out of luck. There is no standard. There is no standard for private wells. The recommendation for private wells is you have it tested to see if it comports with the national standard. But the standard is public water. That's the water that's released from the treatment facility, according to the regulations. So if your water system is producing it at 15 ppb, they are doing the job that's necessary. Now, things that could interfere with that. Interior pipelines from the meter to the home faucets. Depending on the age of the house, it's either metal or plastic. Pre-World War II, metal alloys containing lead. New homes, mostly plastic. Faucets, stainless or aluminum, multiple metals. Connections and fittings, especially in older homes, lead compounds, brass, bronze, added for strength. You can be contaminating your own interior water system and not knowing it. If you have old pipes that tend to knock, tend to be loose, because anytime the pipe moves, you can be knocking off sediment, and that contains material found within the pipe itself. Exterior line, treatment facility to the residence. I looked up, and depending on when the line was put in, it could be metal, it could be concrete, combinations of these materials are used. There is no, as far as I was able to determine, no standard for what they are made out of, other than they have to transport water without leaking. That seems to be the key. You don't want to lose what you're shipping. The pipeline itself has to be treated because, as I mentioned earlier,
over the years, you start building up sediments. And sediments will attach to the interior walls, and the pipes themselves can leach metals. As a chemist would know, if it can be solubilized, it'll come out of pipe. It can break down the bonds, especially in concrete, which, if you've ever worked with concrete, you don't know what's going in there, other than the Portland cement that binds everything together. I have a slide to go into that a little bit later. So let's talk about the elephant in the room, Flint, Michigan. Everybody heard about that one. 2014, residents were exposed to high levels of lead above 15 ppb, and Michigan Department of Environmental Quality report noted that. Began in 2014, the city of Flint changed the water supply. Well, what happened? If you've read the media, pretty accurate. They made an economic decision to not buy treated water out of Detroit. They drew it out of the Flint River. Had a different chemical characteristic. They didn't treat it. It leached everything that I mentioned a few moments ago into the water past the facility, and people began drinking it. Now, the results of this are we had a substantial population, and I'm sure most of you have seen it in the media, that were exposed to the elevated lead. And State of Michigan was involved, the EPA was involved, Department of Justice was involved. It's now civil and criminal lawsuits, or criminal prosecution and civil lawsuits, to be quite accurate. So we're not going to talk about that, other than somebody made an oops. Let's leave it at that. A big oops, maybe, but it was an oops. However, Flint, Michigan, with help from Virginia Tech, with help from the Health and Human Services, CDC, came to a solution to put the water back so it met standards, which meant that the chemicals they were using were stopping the leaching coming from the pipes. And this slide was published from the Michigan DEQ. Goes through 2015, published in December of 2016. And examining the report, it's very interesting, and it's a little hard to see, so we'll just generally go through a couple things here. The gray band is Flint, and this is end of fourth quarter 2015. Here's 2014, fourth quarter when it was measured and reported. Notice that correlates to when the water was contaminated. And 2015, they had some of the transfer done, beginning to go down. Now, as a toxicologist, you'd say, oh, that's interesting. But we go back and we look at back here. Here's Flint, and it seems to be treated in here. We don't know what was going on here. But I found it most interesting. Here's Michigan. It's lower than the contaminated source. Back here, it's back up even with Flint. That's the entire state. So what does that mean? And this is just, we're not measuring water. We're measuring children's blood leads. So what does that tell you? As a toxicologist said, there's other sources involved in creating this blood lead. Yeah, the water was one part of it, but there are other sources. So maybe if I were the toxicologist working the case, I'd start looking at other sources that were contributing to this and the exposed children, just to determine what is a better idea. Because we have on this slide total violations per community water system, 2004 to 2015. It's not unknown to have water systems go out of compliance. Now, here's Southwest. I don't know what it might be, it could be oil wells or something. Doesn't say. I've tried to get the data, but it doesn't say. But, you know, Flint is around here. Detroit's here, Flint's up here. It didn't make the report. So either this was data collected before Flint was known, or Flint was so far down the scale of all these others that maybe we're looking at the wrong area for, and we want to try to correct our water supply. All right, let's move on to another prime source, lead-based paint. Banned in 1978, replaced by latex-based paint. 80% of or more of pre-World War II homes had lead-based paint in the interior construction. So I have to ask, who has a house that was built in the 1930s? Anybody here? 1940s? 50s? Good, good. Lead paint was being phased out. You're probably not going to have an issue if you're sure that there's no lead-based paint. Lead-based paint, the principal factor of elevated blood lead levels, that's BLL, that's toxicology short speak, BLL. From children, according to the US EPA's report in 2013 and CDC in 2014. That means that those homes that have lead-based paint, that lead is, in some cases, 100 years old, turn of the century, 1900s. People are still living there. That lead is peeling off. That lead paint's peeling off and crumbling. And those paint flakes are small enough they'd be considered dust. And they're a factor in children's exposure. The standard for lead dust in house just recently changed in 2017 by HUD. Floor dust is 10 micrograms per square foot. It's not very much. It used to be 100. Window surfaces, 100 micrograms per square foot, used to be 400. Exterior floors, porch, 40 micrograms. This stayed the same, I think. Walls, greater than 7.7 milligrams per centimeter per square centimeter is a hazard. And that's done through XRF. These are other ones are all done through dust wipes. We won't get into technology of how it's done in tonight's lecture, but two methods, two thresholds. If you're above that, you're in violation of the HUD. That's good news if you have a HUD-owned house or HUD mortgage. If you have a private mortgage, private home, EPA's numbers are still the old numbers, which are substantially higher. And I'm not going to get into politics about that tonight, which is too bad. So, CDC's EPA and the American Academy of Pediatrics, all of the pediatricians in the US finally agreed with the two regulatory agencies that lead is a hazard. It's been 10 years coming. The principal cause of childhood lead is dust. Lead-based paint, window sills, baseboards, window troughs, floors, any surface. Flaking, chipping, and peeling paint produces lead-based dust. Friction surfaces. What do you think a friction surface is? Anyone, you know, house. I had a defense attorney ask me that. I gave him a 5-minute lecture, and the judge finally said, I didn't need a PhD. You just say it's the inside of the window frame. That's right. What it is, that's one of the friction surfaces. It's about an inch and a half. Goes up and down. If there's lead-based paint in there, they'll start to flake off. Now, one thing that you need to recognize, lead-contaminated soil, it will be transferred into your house, and it will become a fraction of your house dust. You say, how? Well, you go walk through your yard. If you have a high level of lead, or any level, some fraction of it will be brought in. And in that, we consume will prevent or will develop a hazard to small children, because those of you who have small kids in your house, they're learning to walk. What are they supporting themselves with? Windowsills, walls, doors, wooden banister railings. They go up and down, and what have you seen kids do? Toys, hands, covered, may have dust on it, will go into their mouths. It's a perfect conduit. And I'm not talking the psychological compulsive hand-to-mouth kids, just normal. You'll be producing enough lead dust in a lead-contaminated house to substantially raise the blood lead. This is the current recommendation. It's less than five micrograms per deciliter. I want everybody to look at your little pinky. Well, maybe a quarter of an inch long. If you got a longer finger, maybe a half inch. 5 micrograms would cover about a third of your pinky nail. That's all it takes. And you'll start developing some childhood. The kids' blood levels will go up. Remember what I said? It's not a risk yet, it's an exposure, because we have to factor into what else is going on physiologically. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Now, as I mentioned, soil. The biggest source by far in the environment. Levels will vary by state and region, depending on what the industry is. Not going to poke fingers at any particular area, but if you live near a junkyard, chances are you're going to have some lead in the soils nearby. I'm sorry, that's an automobile recycling facility now. We used to call them junkyards when I was growing up. Old habits die hard. Bare soil, over 400 ppm in children's play area, is considered a threat, because children are out there in the summer. They're playing with toys. If they're particularly young, hands on the ground, toys in the mouth, you're having a lead dust sandwich without the bread. And contaminated soil can be found anywhere, virtually anywhere. When I was at the EPA, we found contaminated soil near apartments that were a mile or so away from smelting facilities. Also found contaminated soil that should have been clean. So you go back in the records and find that a railroad had used it as a marshalling yards 60 years ago. They didn't clean it up, they just buried all of the residue underneath, and it's worked its way up. Got to know what's the area that you're buying into. Okay, some examples of where we are finding this. East Chicago, Indiana, it's an apartment complex built on the side of a lead paint factory. You'd say, why would anybody do that? Doesn't make sense. However, it was urban redevelopment. That area is so contaminated, they're considering tearing the building down because the interiors can't be cleaned. Portsmouth, Virginia, this is what I mentioned. Located in a nice area in Portsmouth, near the Elizabeth River, except a railroad whose name I won't mention owned the land before them. And that smelter was there, and the houses and the apartments were being built. Some of the highest numbers we'd seen on interior lead. This is all subsidized housing, so the people had to be moved out. HUD wasn't going to let them stay there. It couldn't be cleaned. Palmerton, Pennsylvania, not too far from here, was contaminated from a zinc smelter. Exceeded 2,000 ppm, even though it was closed 30 years later. There is still amount of zinc metal tailings. Anybody ski? Go snow skiing? You have a Blue Mountain up there in Palmerton? Don't fall. That's the zinc tailings when they get the snow on it. If you get a cut, you may have issues, but yeah. we're deep patty. Tar Creek, Oklahoma. Great place. It's in the northeast corner of Oklahoma in the tribal lands. 1,100 square mile region. It still had active lead mines until 1990. And you've heard of Mickey Mantle. He used to play baseball for the New York Yankees. He grew up there. That town, that area is so contaminated. The state of Oklahoma moved all of that population out. Because, and we'll get there in just a minute now, the houses couldn't be cleaned up again. Donora, Pennsylvania, another abandoned zinc smelter south of Pittsburgh. That smelter was closed 1950s, 1960, and lead, arsenic, cadmium, and zinc. Smelterville, another lead or zinc smelter, West Virginia, essentially the same area, there, except it wasn't in a town. The owner of that smelter, which is south side of Parkersburg, at least had the common sense not to build it near the town. So, this is Tar Creek. These mounds here, and you can't see the houses very well. This is an aerial photo from 1990s. But these are the piles of waste mining lead. Here's a house. There's a pile of lead right next to it, back here. They call it chat. And chat is nothing but gravel-sized pieces of waste lead. The Native Americans lived there. The locals came in there. They did hunting and fishing. Yeah. So, next, another one, Donora. This is 1945, here's the mill. This is all of the, this is pre-controls on production facilities, so this is all waste material coming out of the stacks, going over the town here. This is Donora up this way. It's in the Monongahela River Valley, about 30 miles south of Pittsburgh. It's, you get a nice circular flow of the waste going around the bend in the river. So what happened in 1948? That little inversion layer? That was the smog layer. Lasted about a week. They have a little Donora Museum there. I've toured it. They show a little quick slide of this. This is a picture from it. And I think they had 14, 18 confirmed deaths back in there. Nobody knew how many died directly from it or indirectly. And this is the sign that they put up there. It's right in the entrance into Donora. And I'm currently working on litigation in Donora. This is one house in Donora, sampled in 2016. The locations, we went from attic to basement. Arsenic levels, well above thresholds for hazard. Cadmium, yeah, cadmium's hazardous, but not quite as bad as lead. 16,000 ppm in the attic. And zinc, which they made, there's 17,000. I mean, this was all from the stacks releasing this. And if anybody's interested, this is the waste product. That was up on the slag heap, and it's public land owned by the city, so I said, oh, they probably won't miss this. Compositions of arsenic, lead, zinc, and cadmium. Quite heavy. Needless to say, the defense, whose name I won't mention, they're a well-known U.S. corporation, is fighting his tooth and nail, saying that, yeah, they did it, but it was so long ago, who cares? That slag heap is still filtering into the Monongahela River, and the people downstream are drinking it. So I say that's an issue. lead in the air. Really what we're talking about after all of this is under regulation promulgated by the EPA for stacks emissions and gasoline. Lead in gasoline, largest source of lead. And lead was starting to phase out in 1979. This is 10,000 metric tons per year. So this was 1.29 million metric tons of lead. This is per day emissions, 1979, 3.5, that'd be 35,000 metric tons per day, gasoline. After the phase out, no more lead in gasoline, it had to be gone. Here is your air lead. You can see it's beginning to decline. Now, there's still some stocks in there, and we're talking about residual bleed off. It seems to have taken more time than it probably should have, but the regulations, as I recall, allowed usage of what the stocks were, and they still were using lead and gasoline overseas until even when I was in Jordan, they had leaded gasoline. They were phasing it out. This was 2005. Took them a while to read. However, it was a success story. This is the gold medals of children born from 1900 to 2008. The national, it's the CDC, National Health and Nutrition Evaluation Survey. Comes out every 2 years. And I won't tell you when I was born, but my birth symbol is a green one. So when I was born, the average blood lead level was a little over 10. And now, if I'm normal, some people would argue that, I'm down to, should be under 5. But what we have shown pretty conclusively is that it's worked. That source in the gasoline is the primary source. Lead in food. As we mentioned during dinner, lead used to be used as a pesticide. Apple orchards, some other obscure uses. Primarily, the old, most recent one, lead in cans. That was only outlawed, I think, about 12 years ago. I mean, if you got a lead soldered can, it's probably bulging. I wouldn't use the food in it anymore. Probably rotted inside. But those cans, those of us who are old enough to remember seeing those, they had a ribbon of lead solder, and the two lids were pressed on. Sometimes they were soldered down. That created the leaching of the lead into that liquid, especially if it was an acid-based material. Lead would come out of that like a freight train. So now we have cans that are totally seamless with a plastic inner lining. I'm not going to tell you what's in the plastic. Well, that's another issue unto itself. Now, survey of lead from the USDA in 2008. The USDA, well, until the past couple of years, the USDA used to conduct a biannual survey of hazards in food. So this is 2008, published in the US EPA's document of 2013. That may have been the last one. USDA did. You can, oops, wrong button. Food types, basic food groups, tacos, cereal, cheese. Milligrams per kilogram, 0.6, that'd be next to nothing. The only one that I couldn't quite figure out was over here in the noodles. You look at the range of the survey indicates that they had some strange grouping of foods that they're calling noodles. Because if they were the standard spaghetti, should be fairly same because they're all coming out of the same wheat. So what are you using for noodles? I don't know. maybe it's worth looking at what we're eating as rice noodles. And other sources, toys. Plastics can contain lead as part of the plasticizer. Or the paint. Well, wait a minute, you said lead paint can't be used. Comes from overseas. China still uses lead-based paint. We know because this litigation, Tommy the Tank, it's a children's toy, size of our hand, looked like a tank, was painted, multicolored, and not only was the paint lead-based paint, the metal contained lead. Kids would put it in their mouth and chew on it. It was litigated, I think finally resolved in 2014. Settlement for the U.S. parties was about $100 million. I worked on the Canadian settlement. The Canadians only took $20 million. So I asked the lawyer in Canada, why didn't you get what the U.S. got? He said, we have fewer people. That sort of made sense. And maybe the Canadian dollar is worth more, too. I'm not sure. I don't. So we now have exposure pretty much identified. So how do we assess what the risk is? Lead's been identified since the ancient days as a chemical of concern. Romans drank their wine in lead cups, lead goblets. They may have had silver and gold, but they were contaminated. That means that you wonder why the Romans stopped being the lead civilization. They were poisoning themselves. The dose response assessment, which means as what is the chronic dose? What is the dose that we need to be concerned with? It's all based on non-human studies and human epidemiologic data. The best study we could use if we had to produce an effect is to use humans, but we can't have very few people want to volunteer to take lead. Then we look at the exposure. What is the risk? What is the exposure to this? And we try to figure out what is the significant effects. Children are different than adults because children are growing. And the effects of the particular organs are most evident in children as they are developing. Us older people, we're not developing, we're just storing it. And that creates a whole different set of problems. Children, the blood test, blood lead level is 5 micrograms. The children should receive, according to CDC, the first blood test at 12 months. And whenever they have resided in lead-contaminated housing, should be an annual basis, or more frequent, depending on what the MD has stated. Adults, if you have a work history of blood lead, you should be tested. Because you can be damaging yourself. Adults, CDC has a recommendation of 10. Haven't quite come down to any way of enforcing this yet, but the recommendation is 10 micrograms per deciliter. On the basis of time, I think we'll skip this slide. It just shows blood lead and the intake. What we are showing here is blood lead is flattening out of its uptake and partitioning in the blood and brain. This is from children's years, 0 through 10. It's a model. What we're seeing here, and you need to recognize this is pretty important when we get down to talking about children's effects. It's contaminating in nervous tissue. That's where it sits. Because the turnover of children growing so quickly, in adults it sits in the bone and larger organs. Kids' organs are constantly turning over. It's going to come in, but the nervous tissue, for some reason, has an affinity for lead. As I stated a minute ago, this is the same curve for adults. With children, we start seeing it go down. Here it is in the body and in the bone in adults. that's where it's stored in adults. That's the toxicological significance of the change in effects. We can talk about this afterwards, but it just shows that lead has effects on every particular system the body uses biochemically. Causal relationships. Cognitive function decrease in children, declines in full-scale IQ, academic performance, and executive functioning, and information processing, children 4 to 11 years of age. So if you're, as I have been, as I do, look at medical records, look at exposure, and if the child has an IQ below what the neuropsychologist says is normal, and we'll say for argument it's 100, and the kid has, or child has, an 85, that's a definite drop. And it's not going to get back. Externalizing behaviors. Attention, impulsivity, hyperactivity. Children, young adults, ages 7 through 21, blood lead ranges 7 to 11 micrograms per deciliter. That's only 2 micrograms above our threshold. We're starting to see hyperactivity, attention deficit. We've seen this in the paper recently. Conduct disorders associated with criminal offenses, auditory function, hearing changes, hearing decline at over 8 micrograms per deciliter. Now, adults, we see different. Cognitive function decrements over 50 years of age include memory loss, learning function, visual spatial skills associated with work history of lead exposure, psychopathological, clinical depression, hypertension, atherosclerosis, coronary heart disease, direct association as an increase in blood pressure, hematological red cells, changes, hematocrits, at very low levels, 3 to 7 micrograms. Reproductive and developmental effects need to be somewhat higher to see this, but I suspect when I looked at the data, there is not a lot of hard, good showing. It might go down. And everybody's big bugaboo, animal studies on a lifetime basis show an increase in cancer. That would be the least one I'd be worried about. Everybody's going to die from something. Cancer is just one of the many. What would worry me at my tender age, which I won't mention, are any of these. At least you have less fulfillment in life. So we have a problem. There's no safe level of exposure for children, but we have to control it. Adults need to minimize. What do? Identify lead-based paint and repair and replace. You, my opinion, from the data I've seen, you cannot scrape lead paint off walls sufficiently to clean it out. You've got to take the window out. You've got to take the contaminated paint. You've got to take the door out. There's a study that was done by HUD that showed the only way to clearly treat a contaminated house is to gut rehabilitate it. Take all the walls out and start again with fresh drywall. And I've done some sampling in those, and that's the case. Now, water systems. Have you well tested? Public water systems report once a year, as I recall the legislation. They have to put out a postcard. Ours puts out a postcard once a year saying what their test was. Private wells. No standards. It's up to the owner to do the testing. So, this is 2010's targeted for enhanced child lead screening in West Virginia. I think there's 9 counties here. I cannot determine why those were picked out, but you all know some of the counties more. I know down in Gailey County and Marion County and Preston County, since I was in Morgantown. I don't recall what these are and why they were left there, but there's been no publication of what the enhanced testing did or showed, or if it's still in the budget. But those of you who live in the state, you might want to start asking questions, because it's not just the house, it's the entire environment that needs to be looked at. Thank you. Question.
Maybe I could start a question. Of all the cases that you're involved with right now for litigation, I wondered if you would share with the audience what you shared with us earlier of what a typical case is like and the difficulty in the overexposure to lead for children because of trying to trace their time of residence.
Sure. When I'm generally handed a case, 95% of the time I work for the plaintiff. They provide me the case history, which includes where the child was living, the years that the child was living, and data to support that, leases, some type of evidentiary acceptable to courts that said the child lived here, 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 and here, and these are the years that we think they lived there, including the months, hopefully. Then I get the survey of the interior conditions of the walls, whether or not they contain lead-based paint. I also get the child's health records. That goes back some, and I had to go back and reread all the medical terminology to try to remember it, because I had forgotten most of it. So I go back and go through all of those. If you've had kids, you know the doctor handwriting is terrible. It's terrible. So I key on looking at lead reports. Find what they have, make my charts. Lead was reported, the blood leads were this, the child lived here, and there was lead in that particular house. Then we try to look at the data points, testimony of the parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles of what would the house was like. If that house had chipping, flaking, and peeling paint and was tested to contain lead paint residue, even though the landlord said, we cleaned it, we painted it, it's still there. That is enough for a finding that that particular residence or residences are more likely than not to have contributed to the elevated blood leads. The neuropsychologist who has the discussions with the child classifies their mental decline, and they all come into the range that we noted on the slides. They have cognitive issues. Their IQ has dropped from the nominal 100 to 90s, 80s. The lowest they've ever seen is 67. That's pretty low. Usually my cases end up going through negotiations and settlement outside of court. Not that I'm any good, but most of my lawyers don't want to gamble on a jury trial. That's what it is. I did do a jury trial this past fall. The other side, the plaintiff, the defense attorney kept asking me, tell me about the surfaces and how they contributed to the snowfall of lead. Well, that's when I went to the visual graphics that my lawyer had provided me. Here's a piece of styrofoam, 2x4, 2x3, I think. I said, the contact surfaces are these edges. If they go up and they go down, there may be a couple of chips coming off, which the mother said she always wiped up. She saw that, she knew it was a problem. She had talked to the landlord, and he was not forthcoming to do the repairs, so she was doing the right thing. She wiped it up with a wet paper towel and threw it away. At least she says you did. Got to believe somebody sometimes. That pretty much took care of the defense attorney's argument that there was a snowfall of lead paint chips. So I gave my testimony, and the defense decided to have a negotiated settlement in front of the judge. It was there. Clearly, that was the only source of lead in that house. Now, where that child actually got lead, I have to say this because the house next door, again owned by the same landlord, had old-fashioned hot water radiator pipes. If you're in an old house, you know these pipes go up multiple floors. Those pipes were peeling, and they were tested positively for lead-based paint. And the child had been seen by the neighbors in that apartment chewing on those lead chips. So, yes, we got both apartments into the settlement, and the landlord has had to come up with money to pay for it. Yes? Yes, there is a drug that can take excess lead out of the body and bone. Not pleasant, it's an IV drug. Last time I saw it, it was an IV drug that would take the lead out of the bone. The problem is, if it's been there that long, it's done its damage. I didn't get into the biodynamics of lead. But most children, their half-life of the lead inside the body is 30 to 45 days, depending on diet. So it's going out at a fairly rapid rate. But the amount of lead to cause damage is so small. That's the causation factor. No. In adults, especially women, lead accumulates in bone and it replaces the calcium in your bones. So you talk about brittle bones, it's osteoporosis. That, when you have elevated blood leads, probably above 20 is from the data I've seen, you're more prone to having that brittle lead. That's why the CDC wants to try to get it down as low as 10 in the blood lead. Because you're going to be passing, lead's relatively dynamic, and bone is dynamic. It's always rebuilding itself. So it's always going to be replacing whatever lead's in there with hopefully calcium if you're drinking enough milk and taking vitamin D and taking calcium pills. Yes? Take it to a certified solid waste facility where it's disposed of. Don't ask that question. It's not a hazardous waste. I didn't write the rule. Lead paint debris is not a hazardous waste. Now, you have to be certified to go in there and do that, and you have to wear the Tyvek suits with a full face mask. So why isn't it hazardous waste? Go talk to the lawyers. I didn't write those. Yes?
So what do we know about, say, cows or sheep, animals that graze in areas that have lead contamination, and then we consume?
I didn't research that, but they will have some level of lead. Undoubtedly. There is a standard that FDA uses and USDA uses for amounts. I just don't know how it comes in to play, because their biodynamics are somewhat different than humans. So they will ingest it. It will go into similar locations as us mammals, and using that analysis, it'll go into the bone in the adults, into some of the organ tissue, and some will go into muscle. Well, muscle is the lowest proportionality of storage in humans, so I presume it's going to be the smallest in animals. I don't have any knowledge firsthand on that. Yes? Well, let's go back. In 2000, the blood lead levels were lowered to 10 from 20. In 2012, CDC began the process of lowering them to 5. We can't go any lower. The national background for blood lead in children is running 2 to 4, depending on where they live and their exposure of any exogenous lead. That's pretty low. I mean, we're not going to get rid of lead. It's a naturally occurring element. So we just need to be careful of how we approach it. And if we do know it's there, we can control its exposure to us, all of the humans, and the animals, too, that we rely upon. Sure. Yes.
Curious about what happens with this human. Not so much chemistry or damage to what happens, but why were there criminal lawsuits there?
I don't know. I believe this is strictly what I have read in the scientific journals, the processing facility used the wrong chemicals. That's what. That's up to the lawyers to argue about. Obviously, the legislation says if you've done this, you know, criminal complaint can be launched. Whether it was justified, that's up to a judge and jury. Any other questions? That may have been the tipping point. But I try to steer away from criminal cases. They're a lot harder to deal with than civil cases.